good job. Slap somebody high five, have a seat. This is a day that you're allowed to be rowdy today. Is that okay? So if we have good news, it is good news. Never seen anybody sad about good news, right? It's exceedingly glad. That's what happened whenever people received good news from Jesus. They were exceedingly glad. Let me tell you, you are the church. You're God's big idea for the earth. You're it. Wouldn't it be great if all authority was given to you to get the job done? Wouldn't that be great? Well, it's true. It has been. Wouldn't it be amazing if you were completely faultless and blameless before the throne of God, and anything that you asked, he said ask, so that you could receive, so that you would be joyful? Wouldn't that be great? Well, it's true. Is that good news? It's good news. You're the church. This morning, during worship, it was like, man, we were bumping up against the ceiling. Sometimes you just got to shout. You just got to let it rip. Amen? You can do that at home, too. Looks a little weird sometimes. Just put your headphones on, though. No one else will know. We are thankful to be back. We just arrived back in the States on Thursday. Is that right? We got back on Thursday. Technically Thursday. We took a team of 13 folks over to an event called Lark in the Park in Sidcup, England. It's a church that's part of the Pioneer network of churches that we belong to. They do an amazing event that goes on for about 2 weeks every year. This was our fourth consecutive year to send teams over. So what's fun is we've been sending teams for the past 4 years, and now stories are starting to come back from our people and from their investment into this city of Sidcup and the church that's located in England. How many of you know there's just one church? There's just one family. That's what we are. We're one family. Family celebrates differences, and they talk a little different than we do. I don't understand. It's kind of weird. They speak English, but they don't sound the same. So what we've got is we're going to show real quick, and as this concludes, I want the team just to come up. So go ahead, and we're going to roll a video of what this kind of looked like.
I got this feeling inside my bones. It goes electric, wavy when I turn it on. All through my city, all through my home. We're flying up, no ceiling when we in our zone. I got that sunshine in my pocket. Got that good soul in my feet. I feel that hot blood in my body when it drops. Ooh, I can't take my eyes off of it. Moving so phenomenally. Come on, like the way we rock it. So don't stop. And under the lights when everything goes. Nowhere to hide when I'm getting you close. When we move.
A lot of happy faces in there, wasn't it? Let the team come on up. So what the event is essentially 2 weeks. Just to give you some perspective, the church in Sidcup, their New Generation Church is their name. They're about 250 people in their body. And they put on this event, which approximately 2,000 people a day come through. And out of 250 people in their church, they fund about 90% of what it costs to put this on every year. They've been doing it 20 years. This was their 20th year. It's six figures to put this on. And the church gives more than 90% of what it costs to put it on. And what they're doing, what they're finding 20 years into this, is people are discovering church. So they don't apologize about being the church, but they decided, you know what, we're going to show people what church looks like. And so whenever they meet the church, it's going to look different than what they were used to seeing. So these people extravagantly love their city. And during this two-week period of time, what's amazing is the pastor, Paul Weston's his name, the police came to him and said, you know what's incredible about this 2 weeks? During the 2 weeks that this event runs in the city, we have absolutely no crime. The crime rate goes to zero. They had one arrest a couple of years ago, so the crime rate went up 100% that week. Amazing what happened, because this event takes place on the highest place in the city. So the park is located in the high place of the city. So imagine what happens whenever God's house invades and sits in the high place of a city. Pretty amazing, isn't it? So all of these guys are going to share stories. You got microphones. Whoever wants to let it go, let it go. They're going to share stories of their experience. And I want to tell you, this team was absolutely incredible. What's fun whenever you go and you get to lead is you get to watch people step out in faith. But the reports back from the pastor specifically saying that when you guys come, the actual the watermark, if you want to call it that, faith just rises whenever these people show up. And so it was an absolute privilege to take this team and to represent your body. Just know that all of you that prayed and gave, one, thank you. So, fire away.
This was my first missions trip to London. It was a battle to get there, and I had to fight what my identity was. I had questions about my motives. I had doubts in my relationship with God. I had suggestions that I couldn't accomplish the mission. I had attacks about just how well I could do what God wanted me to do. But you know, when you step out and you obey God, you find out that's just the enemy's tactics. And so my first challenge was to prophesy over a little girl. We got asked, apart from the rest of the team, to minister over three teenage girls. And Julie and I grabbed Carol because she was more experienced. And I stepped across my real chicken zone and line, whatever you call it. Anyway, and the Lord gave me something for her. And by the time we finished ministering to these three girls, there were tears of, and you could just tell the Holy Spirit was ministering to them. And God was faithful to give me what I needed in order to do the job. The second challenge was to run a concession stand with Carol, not knowing what English money looks like. And suddenly realizing, oh, this isn't American money we're dealing with. I only had to give back a pound to one gentleman who came back up and said, you shortchanged me, blah, 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 blah. And I said, how much do I owe you? Let me just give it to you. But that was our funny challenge. But the rest of them, God supplied every need. And we were just blessed to serve him and to love the people that were there.
When I was there, everybody had their favorite part of the week, but mine personally was a treasure hunt. So we were all eating dinner, not all of us. Some of us were eating dinner, so I suggest that we should just do a treasure hunt. So everybody starts praying. We write down on our paper all of our clues, and then we start walking back to the park. So everybody has something that was there, and then I just see somebody sitting at a table. I say, there's my guy, and I take off. So everybody else is, that was there was running after me, trying to catch me, of course. And so while all that's going on, I finally arrive, and we start talking to him. So I had down black shirt, blue shoes. So the guy had a black shirt, and the guy next to him had blue shoes. So we prayed for all three people right there, all three of them. I had trouble breathing and skinny. So the doctors kept telling him he was a little overweight, the guy in black shirt, and if he lost more weight, he wouldn't have his trouble breathing. So we prayed for him, and then also he had done something with his shoulder and arm, and he couldn't lift it past this area. And after we were praying for him, he was just lifting as high as he could reach. So, the biggest miracle that I'd say was the person with the blue shirt, he had moved his joint, like his joint was all the way up, like midway through his hand, and we started praying for him because he had punched a wall. So we started praying for him, and he said that his hand felt like it started heating up and someone was pulling his finger, and we looked down and his joint had, or his knuckle had moved all the way down to where it should have been.
So hang on. Just in case you don't know what a treasure hunt is, essentially you just ask the Lord to show you just some clues to know, all right, God, who's on your mind? So we usually do about five things, like a location, a name, how the physical appearance of how to know who they are if you see them, what they need prayer for, and then if there's just anything unusual. So all these guys were just asking, Lord, show us, you know, maybe what they're wearing or what they need prayer for, or you know, anything else that may be unusual. So they literally wrote all these clues down. And then as we go to the park, we find these people who literally match all of the clues. So just so if you don't know what a treasure hunt is, that's what that looks like.
Okay, so England, it was really fun. And when we were eating dinner, we decided to do a treasure hunt. And when we got all our things wrote down in maybe 5 minutes, maybe. And then we went to the park, and we saw our guys once we went into the gate, and we started going. And my guy was this guy. He was not an adult. He was a kid. He was having depression, and we prayed for him. And we had about 3-4 miracles happen in that day, and it was cool.
Yeah, absolutely. It was good. Good job.
So when we were at Lark in the Park,
hold up there. There you go.
There was this girl that immediately passes out. Like, she has a disease that she can pass out any time. And she passed out during church, and everybody was praying for him, and it wasn't working. So they decided to bring me and Abel in to pray for him. And then I saw an image of her blinking and then getting up and running, and that's exactly what she did.
So what did you learn, too, that whenever you felt like you heard the Lord, what did you learn about whenever you saw somebody, how the Lord was showing you that, how you learned that? Won't you tell them?
I learned that because if the Lord shows you someone specifically, you don't have to say, does anyone have something? But you can ask that person if they have it.
There you go. Yeah. Yeah, so just to follow up the rest of that story with those folks, is anybody telling the rest of that? So there was four folks there in this family. And out of five of us that just wrote down clues, there's about 40-something things that were written down. These four people had 30 of them. So God was obviously, like, just after these people. And one of the coolest things that I heard, the lady that's sitting there in the chair, after it was over, I mean, there was literally about four miracles physically that happened like that. She said, would you take a picture of our family so we can remember what God did for us today?
I was going to say, too, because it was an experience having our three young sons with us. And we're eating dinner that night, and Warnick was like, let's do a treasure hunt. And I was like, all right, great. It's going to be a great opportunity. They've done them in the past. But it was going to be an awesome experience for them to do it. But while we were working on it, and Chris was leading us and helping us to pray for the different things, and the boys are acting like 10-year-old boys, and they're goofing around and throwing food. And I was just so frustrated. And I was like, it's not going to work. And I'm only going to write down 4 things and, you know, whatever. We'll do it. It's going to be great. And we're walking in. I'm literally just discouraged because my 10-year-old son's not acting like a 40-year-old man in this treasure hunt. And he's got his list. I'm like, yep, good luck with that, son. And literally, though, we walk in and he says, there's my guy. And I'm like, all right, have fun. And we go with him. And then it starts happening and happening. Happening, and it was names. We had these guys' names, and we were able to give them the names that the Lord had given us, and it was actually their specific name, and that the Lord knew who they were. So it's just amazing to watch God work through all the team's lives and see him speak. Because like Chris said, it was Abel had 7 out of 7, Warnick had 5 out of 5, Noah had 5 out of 5, and the only 4 things. I wish I'd written down more because all 4 of mine got matched up. So. Anyways, it was a powerful, powerful night. And like Chris said, she said, take a picture so I can remember this day that God did this for us.
The best way for me to describe Lark in the Park is you think of Vacation Bible School on steroids. It's just incredible. I worked in registration with Carol, and we were signing up kids for the preschool group, and the preschool group, the parents go in with them, and they have face painting and games and crafts, and they teach them that God loves them, and that venue can hold 1,000 people. They had 800 one day, 800 people in just the preschool group. It was amazing. Then they had like 5 to 7, and then 7 to 11, yeah, 7 to 11, and then 11 to 14. So if your kids were in that, they also had a venue set up for the adults to do arts and crafts. That's where Jan worked. For 10 days, they had 5 different craft events every day. You could walk in and choose 5 new ones every day. Just what blew me away was the organization among the people, the way they handled all of this, you know, 1,000 people coming in, and the planning that had to go into it to make it all come together. And the blessing of it is, there was the woman working next to me said that earlier in the first week, this woman had come in with like 3 or 4 kids, and you could tell she was just frazzled to the max, just. And so Sharon helped her get registered, get her kids in the system, and then delivered them to where they needed to go and went with her and got everything settled out. When she came in the next week and was coming to the activities, she was calm, she was peaceful, and she said, there's just something about the atmosphere in this place. People were being in church without realizing they were being in church. And the Spirit of God moving over that whole facility was just incredible. Just incredible.
I just wanted to quickly say that we had 10-year-olds, we had 30-somethings, and then we had 50-somethings. And so it's a wide range of what we had going this year. And we had a prophetic night, started at 10 p.m., where all the volunteers that wanted to come would come, and we would minister over them. And to see all of our team, every one of them, God showed up. And so every one of our team stepped over that chicken line. And what happens when you step over that chicken line is God shines brighter in you. So that's what I wanted to share with you guys, because that's what you guys can have too, is just step over whatever that chicken line is for you guys, and God's going to shine even brighter in you.
So the lady in the wheelchair on Sunday morning, basically like halfway through the week, Chris told us, like, ask God for something you want to see happen. And something that'll, yeah. So I asked for healing. I wanted to see someone get healed. So on Sunday morning, there was a lady in the wheelchair, and Nathan was praying for her. So I went up after I was praying for a lady and started praying with him. And Nathan told her to stand up. So she stood up, and we were praying for her. And then she just collapsed over on the ground. And we prayed for the longest time. And then Noah had that vision of her opening her eyes. So she opened her eyes right then, and she got water, and then she said, I want to stand up. And so she stood up, and then she was like, I feel like I should walk around this whole place. So she starts walking, and then she was like, God's telling me 7 times, like in Jericho. So she starts walking, and on like the 6th one, she like goes, I want to run. So she takes off her shoes, and we all start running with her. And yeah, so.
And this lady, I'm praying for folks up at the front. This is after Sunday morning service, and I'm just catching this out of the glimpse of the corner of my eye. Like, I know she's down. I know kids are praying, so, you know, you're aware of what's going on. And the next thing I know, like, she's being helped, like, around the circle. And every time she would come by, so imagine a tent the size of this room. These are the tents that they had up. Like, I decided real quick after we tore them down that I was not going to be in carnival life. Not the path that I'm going to end up taking at some point, because these things are massive. So she's just walking, and then about the 5th or 6th time I see her come by, she's literally jogging completely on her own. And so I'm watching the next night when she comes in to see, all right, you know, what's going on? Is she still someone pushing her in? She has zero wheelchair, like not a wheelchair with her, walking in on her own. Unbelievable.
It was that morning, because Chris got to lead the service, and so, like he said, we were all up there praying for people, I love praying for people to be healed, and it's always amazing. I was up there praying for this lady, and Abby comes up, and she's like, hey, come pray with us. We're praying for this lady, and I'm looking over there, and I was like, you know, I definitely want to do that, and then I felt like the Lord was saying, no, don't go over there, and she was completely surrounded by the children, and God told me just to don't go over there. And Abby goes back over there, and like Chris said, you're praying for other people, and you're looking around, and all of a sudden, you know, every couple of minutes, you'd see them swing back around. It's like, oh, Lord, what are they doing to that poor woman they're praying for? But it was amazing, and by the end of it, they're running, and it was great, but I felt like the Lord was telling me, it's the children, and these children carry that same authority and that same spiritual authority to pray for healing. And so it was real powerful to see the children acting that.
And what was cool was that God had told this woman, her name was Liz, she had post-viral fatigue, which is an autoimmune disorder. This was like her 3rd wheelchair she'd been trying out to try to function in. And she said that the Lord had told her if she would get the kids over to pray for her, that's what she needed to do. So it was just amazing watching these guys work.
I just wanted to add to that several people after that night and after what was going on during the week, they came up to me and was telling me about the kids. They could not imagine how these kids, the 10-year-olds, were ministering and the teenagers were ministering. So I think we left that there.
Also, the place that I worked in one night we had like 20 kids saved, so I'm going to move marbles for them.
And then we had, in the youth services that I got to be a part of, we had 11 the first night, and 1 the next, and then 4 the following. So if you can move 15 or 16 for those too, Abby. If there was, the only thing I would say that I brought back was, and I think Julie hit on it, was the woman that was there that had been in church for 2 weeks and didn't realize it. And it was the buy-in that this community, I talked to volunteers throughout the week as we'd be doing stuff. I'd be like, how did you get plugged into Lark in the Park? And they didn't go to that church. They just happened to live in the area. And it was the buy-in that people had bought into the DNA that they were going to love the city and that they were going to be the church. And so it wasn't a deal where they'd bring everybody into the tent and just hammer and proselytize and just preach at them. It was loving them. And I feel like it was just a constant love and a hug. And when you think about time with your father, it was a love. It wasn't a conviction. It wasn't a judge. It was just loving everybody exactly where they were at. And there was, and I went to the whole deal looking at it and seeing what could we bring back. I don't expect us to come back and go set up in the middle of the city and spend $100,000 and create a Lark in the Park Russellville. But what I do want is for us to have the heart to love our city like these people do for that many, for that time period, and what it does and how it transforms the community, and to be able to impart our DNA into the city, and the city not even realize it, that they're being loved by their Father through that.
Amen. It's good. It's good. Anybody else? Anybody got anything else? No? This guy did a good. This gang did a good job. Let's give him a big hand. Hey, you boys, come on out.
You want to hang real quick, people?
We have two of the team. Carl and Becky were sticking around. The Sid Cup was the name of the town that we were in. Well, they do the same thing after they do 2 weeks. They pack it up, and they carry it about an hour down the road to another church that they're in relationship with, and they do it all over again. And I'm talking to Paul the day before that starts in Ramsgate, the name of the town. I'm like, how in the world do you guys do this? I mean, they are operating at a capacity that I'm just amazed by. And the other part that I was absolutely convicted of is watching the amount of buy-in they had in their church. I mean, their people were taking their own vacations to come serve the city in this thing. And, I mean, their heart, I was just so right. And so when you see that, it was convicting on a personal level that these people were, they weren't just saying or giving money towards it. They were spending their time. They were spending their vacation, like, investing into this city. And so the amazing thing is year after year, now they've done it. They have people that just want to volunteer. And as a result of that, they end up meeting Jesus. And I believe what I've brought back that I felt like the Lord had shown me was just that right there. We can do evangelism. We can go out and do, quote, do evangelism, and I'm all for that. I'm all for us doing that, and we will keep doing that. What they're doing is they're just sharing life. They're just sharing life, and that, to me, looks a lot like Jesus. He came that you would have life, and everywhere he went, he shared life. He brought life to wherever he went. And I believe everyone can do that. So you would probably say, well, I'm not an evangelist. And you may or may not be, I don't know. But the reality is you can share the life of Jesus. He is a generous God. And because he's generous, you're generous because you're made in his image. And your job is to share that life with someone, with somewhere, with the city. So how many of you, let me ask you this question. How many of you feel called to another country? Called to another country. Okay, so we've got about six or seven, which is absolutely amazing. The other 95% of you, if you're not called there, you're called here. Got it? If you didn't just raise your hand and you're not called there, that's what it means. You're called here. So to be a missionary here, you're going to have to start thinking missionally. The church isn't this building. One day the building could be closed. We could have a government one day that says, you know what, no more churches in buildings. It's probably closer than we can imagine, but that could be a possibility. You won't have church. You can't have a building. What would you do? Would the church still exist? Yes. Absolutely, it still exists. You know why we exist? Because Jesus is at the center. Of any time two or more gather together, he's in their midst. So how about this? Why don't we carry church wherever we go? Wouldn't that be a good idea? I started with this, and we kind of laughed, but what about if all authority was given to you to come exercise the kingdom of heaven wherever you went? I believe authority looks like this. When we begin to love as much as he loves and hate what he hates evil, he loves what's good. When we begin to operate with that kind of love for what he loves, which is people, which is places, which is seeing redemption, which is seeing broken things made whole. We begin to love like he loves and hate what he hates, hates the evil that the enemy's put, hates the lies that he's spoken to people. I'm telling you, authority will come. Authority rests on you because you are the church. You are the church. You are it. You are a living, breathing example of what heaven should look like as it comes into environments. That's the truth. So when Jesus came and he preached, he says, the kingdom of God is now at hand. Repent. Change the way you think. The kingdom of heaven. When he came proclaiming that good news, it was actually a proclamation like they would have in the day if there was a king. they would have someone that they called the Carricks who would carry this proclamation out. So if I was king and we came in and we invaded your land and we took your land over, I would send my guy out and I would say, okay, now go read the proclamation that this land now belongs to the king. This now belongs to a new king. And so when you go proclaim the good news of the kingdom, you're going to proclaim, guess what? The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, he's here. So if I love what he loves, I'm going to see peace released. I'm going to see wholeness released. I'm going to see salvation happen because I'm just sharing the life of what happens in the kingdom. So it's not just doing. It's not just going and doing some event, some program, which we'll do. We want to introduce people into the church and to Jesus any way we can. But if we don't personally say, I didn't raise my hand, so I know I must be called here, if we don't accept that responsibility, we won't go do it. We just won't. We'll look for somebody else to go do it. And the shift that's happened, so the name of this series is Shift, and ours is about nations. The shift that's happening is the church is going to start going to be in the church. I announce that to you. I believe that's true. Prophetically, I believe it's true because I believe that was the design Jesus had when he set it up, that it wouldn't be a monument in the location. It would be a movement of him. We could not fit Russellville inside these walls. Couldn't if we tried. So the question would be, and we've laughed because it's a great question to ask, is what if the walls were locked? What if the doors were shut for 3 months and you couldn't come here? What would it look like for you? What would you go do to go be the church and have church move in a city? What would you do? It's not a rhetorical question. I want to know what's in your heart to do. Open your house. What would you do? Would you feed somebody? Would you open your house? Would you just worship together, maybe with your neighbors? Would you do something at work? Would you do something in your job? Would you do something with your kids that you're not doing now? So the question is, why are you not doing it now? Why am I not doing it now? So there's some ownership that we're going to have to take. If we are the church, we're God's big idea. Let me tell you, he's coming back for us. He's coming back for us. So we're going to start looking at it different. That's a shift. That's a shift in how you've got to think. And God always starts there. Change the way you think. Change the way you behave. That's what happens. Change your mind. Change the way you live. So what happens when the kingdom comes? The kingdom comes, it's these five things. When the church shows up and his kingdom arrives, it's this right here. We recognize that Jesus fulfilled every promise in history, every one, that the kingdom of heaven would exist on earth. So that the church would, what? It would be the house of God. It would be the moving, living, breathing presence of God wherever you go inside of you. Number two, we believe that when the kingdom shows up, we recognize Jesus' life, death, and resurrection accomplished everything. That tells me that when we show up, nothing's impossible. It's not. It's nothing's impossible. Number three, we recognize when the kingdom shows up that because we have the king, he rules over all things. I don't have to wonder. I don't have to say, God, I need to pray this in. I need to recognize all victory exists over here where I live. And I get to see it released back over here. So don't pray from a place of, God, would you please do? Come over here and say, God, what would you want me to do? I believe you purchased everything. Show us what this looks like on how to release this here. We're not asking him to do something. He already accomplished it. There's not anything left in the cross. He did everything he came to do. If you're waiting for more, guess what? It is finished. That was the word. It is finished. The presence of the Holy Spirit signifies the rule and the reign in my life, that I get to fulfill the destiny that God has for me. You get the same thing. You get to exist in that same kingdom. You get to be you. What I love about the team is everybody got to be who they were. Nobody had to be any more than that. So when Carol gets up and shares, have her share in the chapel, she gets up and just shares her own part of her story. And I don't know how many people came up after that she prayed with that her story spoke to. What the enemy had meant for bad, God turns and he makes for good. So I watched that, and they don't have to be any more than you. And Jan gets up, and she just shares the word of the Lord, and she's just being her. The boys get up, and they just share. A couple of times I was amazed because I just said, okay, after we got through with some of the services, I would say, okay, with what you saw, tell me what you felt like you learned from that. So they would say, like, well, I knew whenever I felt like someone had headaches that we were to pray for that. I felt like I knew who it was, and when they stood up, I recognized I knew that was that person. Well, they're just learning. They're just learning to exercise the gifts that God's given them. They just got to be them. You get to do the exact same thing. And if you miss it, guess what? You miss it. I'd rather you do that. I'd rather you go for it. Absolutely, rather you take risk than I had to sit back and not see something happen. I want to be more afraid of if I don't obey God, you would give the assignment to somebody else. I'd rather be more afraid of that and move than I'd have you be afraid of failure. So the reality is when his kingdom shows up, we get to declare all things get made new. So that's the church. That's us. That's where what we're moving into whenever we begin to see ourselves planted as missionaries in a location, not a building. Listen, the church is the church in Russellville. It just is. Church is family. It's supposed to look like family. Religion says you have to meet some kind of form. That's what religion says. The kingdom says we're going to celebrate diversity, just like your family. Everybody's got a weird uncle in their family, right? Maybe you are the weird uncle in the family. Maybe I'm the weird uncle in the family. Where's Luke? You celebrate diversity because that's what family does. Family says there's a mom and a dad and there's room for you. Religion says we've got to agree on everything. It says we've got to agree on everything. That's how you get denominations. Now, I'm not knocking denominations, but that's how you get those. If you can't fit into what this looks like, you won't be a part of this denomination. We're not going to be about that because we're the family. We're not going to speak ill of our family. Those people are our family. We're going to take the long view. We're going to begin to take the long view of reaching a city. Not a short view where we say, okay, we're okay with just one win over here. That's not the attitude we're taking. And when I look at the church in Sidcup, that's the attitude they've all adopted. We're going to take the long view. This will take longer. Taking a city will take longer. But if we love it and we continue to love it and we continue to invest, now they're running schools and now they just had a library closed and they said, well, that's a shame. People should be able to have a library in their city. We'll run it. And all of a sudden favor comes because they just take some risk. I'm like, who would have even thought about that? The church run a library? Why wouldn't they do that? That's the long view. Andy, you can come on back up. So I believe if you're not called there, you're called here. And the reality should be, I want you just to think, as this week goes on, I literally want you to think, if this house didn't exist and those doors got locked, in 3 months you had to be the church outside of here, what would you do? And I'm not asking that like, hey, this is an idea, and maybe you should think about it. I really believe that's one way to help discover what God put in your heart. And then whatever that step looks like, go do it. I had one guy say, man, I want to wash clothes. Like, I want one of those trucks that can show up, you know, for homeless people, and they can wash. And I don't have the money to buy one of those big trucks. I just said, well, have you got any quarters? Just go down to the laundromat, pump some quarters in there. Amen. If you don't have $100,000 to buy the truck, I bet you got some quarters in your truck rolling around. Let's just do that. So if it's, hey, I want to open my house, that's amazing. Like, knock on the door next door and say, hey, would you like to come? I'm going to cook dinner. I'd just like to have you. I think that's the kingdom of heaven beginning to expand. I believe that's what's happening wherever we do that. So I want to challenge you. Think about it. If it's, man, I would love to go down and help kids at the Boys and Girls Club. Perfect. They need people to help read the kids. It's perfect. Carry the kingdom of heaven in there. See what happens. So I want to challenge you. The shift is that it's going to go less of, hey, come here, and us. It's going to move to us, go there. You know why? Because Jesus said go. That's what he said do. So that's what we're going to do. Okay? Can be scary, but I'm telling you, if we're living in fear, we're living in the wrong kingdom. Right? So I hope the story's helped. I hope the testimony's helped. The amazing thing is whenever you go, you go with an expectation to see God anytime you take a trip. And I'm like, man, I'd like to carry that same expectation to work tomorrow when I get up. That's the long view. That's that I'm missionally, I'm planted in a city. I'm not moving. I'm here. So what we're going to do is we want the team to come back up to begin to pray for folks at the end. You guys come on back up. What we're going to do is we'll just close. We'd like to offer the same thing we offer them. If you would like some prayer in your life, number one, if you want to hear the voice of the Lord clear, I believe that's one thing he'd like to do today, that this team, I would love for them to pray for you for that, because I believe they're carrying that. If you have, let me just tell you this, if you have pain in your knees or in your hands, we're not going to pray for you, because I believe God's already started doing something in your knees and in your hands. During worship, I heard the scripture where it says, strengthen the feeble knees, make strong the weak hands. That just means God's already doing something in knees and in hands. So if that's you, I just need you to stand up whenever we get through here and just check that out and see what kind of improvement's happening. Because that's God. That's God. He spoke it, so he's already doing it. When he speaks, he creates. He does. He does what he says he would do. So if you've got... if you've got that going on, just stand as we all begin to stand. Just stand and check that out. Once you guys just stand, we're going to pray for you at the end. Real simple. My heart is just that we would be who God intended for us to be, just the church. That's my heart. And the heart of God, I believe, is that we just begin to take some steps of faith in this hour to go be who he says we are as a church. So, Lord, I pray, God, that you would begin to draw out of hearts, Lord, what you put in each one of these people to do. Lord, I pray that we would take that serious and we would understand that's actually a call, a calling from God. So, Lord, I thank you that your Holy Spirit is going to interrupt people. I thank you that even now, the Holy Spirit, that you're just interrupting people. Lord, we give you permission to interrupt our patterns, our routines, to go be the church that's willing to lay down some time, lay down some life, to go give life, and to see people changed. And Jesus, just move us, just shift us. We give you permission to interrupt us. We give you permission to interrupt us, God. Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done. And Lord, I pray that you would wipe off any... Lord, any fear, Lord, any disappointment from stepping out. Lord, even as you are filling folks fresh and anew today, Lord, I pray for fresh ideas and creativity from heaven. Lord, that we could be about the business, Lord, as a sign, Lord, it doesn't look like churches are doing it. Lord, I thank you that you've given us a mandate to go lead away of what it looks like for the church to be the church in this hour. Lord, I thank you that you put that on this house to go and do. So, Lord, let that heart of a missionary settle into us, Lord, a long view of seeing a place changed. We bless you, God. I thank you for the folks that are here. If you've got needs, why don't you just come on forward and get prayer. If you've got needs and you find out there's still something we didn't mention that you need prayer for, it'd be a shame to leave here today carrying the same thing you brought in. And if you don't, why don't you just reach around, hug somebody, bless them, tell them I hope you have an amazing week. You look great. Just tell them something like that. Bless you. Have a great week.